All right, welcome everyone. We're going to begin today. My name is Rebecca Burgess, and I'm the founder and director of the Fibershed. And this is our third annual wool symposium. And I just wanted to thank you all for spending a Saturday to come here. And I know the room will continue to fill up throughout the morning. We have a sold-out event, and we've let many extra feet and arms into the room. So get comfortable as the room gets more crowded. And I also wanted to thank those who are in the periphery of the room, the talented artisans and farmers who have spent years, decades, refining their practice on the land and with the knitting needles and the spinning wheels to bring all of this beautiful land-based material culture to you. And it's all recognizable in that it's an expression of our region. This is all local fiber, local dye, meaning it was grown here, and it was materialized through the hands of the people who sit before you. So I'm going to just give you a brief overview, a little bit of the Fibershed project as it stands, and then we're going to move into our breed panel. Today is an agricultural salon. It's a commitment that we've all made to come together and share direct experience from the land. And from those of us who spend time in the artist studio, it's important and valuable to listen to the people who are raising the materials that you then manipulate into the beautiful things you do. If you come from a brand, you're here to also learn from the people on the land and know what it takes to make the raw material to materialize the material culture. So this is a salon of an exchange of ideas. Many different land management practices are represented. And this year, we are going to be talking about a cultural ecology and a natural ecology. So the cultural ecology is expressed today in you all sitting here. The natural ecology will eke through these beautiful discussions and conversations. So next slide. This is a Wendell Berry quote, and I'm just going to make sure I can read it. So we've lived our lives by the assumption that what was good for us would be good for the world. We have been wrong. We must change our lives so that it will be possible to live by the contrary assumption, that what is good for the world will be good for us. And that requires that we make the effort to know the world and learn what is good for it. And I think that that's what these symposiums are truly about, is getting to know the world so that we can make choices that will basically in turn be good for us, but they have to be good for the whole world as a whole. And I love Wendell Berry, sixth generation Kentucky farmer, Christian man, beautiful poet. Thank you for that. So that's the foundation for today, understanding our world, our community, and our region. Next slide. So in 2012, we just explored very basically for all of you, terroir to skin. What is the land base? Who are the people on it? And what's in the backyard of the Bay Area? We have so many urban dwellers, and we have so many beautiful ranches and farms that go to the California state border and beyond. Literally, these are one-day drives from the Bay Area. So how do we tap into with our urban? Those of us who live in urban areas have a certain economic power in a way. We have a certain consumer decision-making power. How do we get to know what's immediately before us? And so the first year was just getting to know the farmers, getting to know the ranchers and the herders. So we spent all of 2012 doing that. And in the Wendell Berry model, we went out and actually surveyed the landscape. And we went through all of California, and this is our sample size. We went out and got two fingers width worth of wool from every ranch and farm that we could get to during shearing season, and we found out that California's wool, as shown here, there's more than 800,000 pounds that's 21.1 to 25 microns. This is a sweater. This could be an outerwear piece. We have plenty of wool, and this is not the wool represented in this room per se. The wool represented here is already being articulated through the hands of knitters and hand spinners. These people have already added value. When we went out onto the landscape, we were looking for the wool that ends up in the landfill, the orchard, or gets sent to China. And so this is what we found, that a lot of this wool has extreme value. So we We just went out and quantitatively and qualitatively analyzed it. It was the first time anyone had done this in the United States. So now we know what's there. We know it's in the backyard. That was 2012. Let's see. And then in 2013, we developed an understanding of our soils. We brought to you emerging science that was based on 7 years of research that happened in the Sierra foothills and West Marin. And it was an attempt to understand how to regenerate our rangelands while simultaneously pulling CO2 out of the atmosphere. How can we enhance the Earth's natural carbon cycle? It's already before us. We're in the biosphere. We're carbon-based life forms. The soil is filled with soil carbon. The atmosphere is filled with carbon dioxide. The oceans are filled now with carbonic acid. No more carbon could come or go from our planet unless NASA sends a rocket ship off or a meteor comes to town from outer space. Carbon's finite. So how do we materialize and enhance a natural cycle? We just have a little too much carbon in one place. It's our atmosphere. If you move it into the soil, it becomes a great benefit to all of us. Water follows carbon. Wherever there is more carbon, there will be more water. So these are the findings from 7 years of peer-reviewed research from the biogeochemical lab at UC Berkeley. So we know that we can sequester 2,000 pounds of carbon per hectare per year for 30 years. We know that in the first year, we can sequester 38 tons of carbon per hectare per year if we use a diverted waste stream, which is an urban waste stream, like what could become compost from Oakland or San Francisco. We then know that the water sequestration is 26,000 liters per acre, and that we also know we can increase forage 50 to 70%. These are conservative averages taken on 35 different soil sites. We bracketed all of California's soils in this scientific analysis, and this was research done by UC Berkeley, Marin Carbon Project, the UC Extension Service, MALT, Marin Organic. Next slide. So just so you know what that means, if we took 5% of California's rangelands and we applied compost, we would actually offset all of the agricultural forestry emissions and all the emissions from the commercial sector just by applying a half inch of compost onto 5% of the rangelands. So just so you have a context of how powerful restoring our rangelands could be, what it means for all of us on planet Earth. And again, increased water holding capacity, increased forage production, it's all due to the slow release fertilization that occurs when you put compost on the ground. Next slide. And then we defined what it would mean to take the wool that's currently not being valued, and we created a technical roadmap. How many machines? What's the square footage? How do we recycle all the water? Is it geothermal, heat pumps? What will it take to materialize, like the clothes that I'm wearing today, which are 100% wool? How do we clothe more people with the wool that's currently not being utilized? And here's a technical roadmap. It's a vision, and it's a very expensive vision that cannot be manifested on the ground until there is a demand. So next slide. We know that if we use a mill, as I described, plus the wool in California that I've also described, the undervalued wool, not always the wool represented in the room, we have very well-loved wool in this room. this means that we could create clothing that actually becomes a carbon sink. And so if you look at the 1, 2, 3, fourth bar down, where you start looking at one item of wool clothing could relate to 10.8 kilograms, that's around 22 pounds of emissions. We can start improving all of this if we put compost on the landscape and we use a renewable energy powered regional supply chain that keeps jobs in California. We can make garments that secure or sequester 37.3 kilograms, around 75 pounds of CO2. You could be wearing a carbon sink, and that's the goal. So this LCA was done by Dr. Marcia DeLange from UC Berkeley, and the full life cycle assessment is downloadable, so you can read all of the spreadsheets and see what went into this. Next slide. So we know whether, irregardless of your care or concern about climate, we know, again, that this rangeland restoration brings more forage, and drought has affected everyone. So when we put carbon in the soil and we know that water follows it, and we can secure more water, and we can secure a longer rangeland, so I would call it a longer grazing season, we know that this is a benefit to us all. And it doesn't matter what angle you approach this from or what your needs and wants are. I would say it'd be great to follow the Wendell Berry model that what's good for the world is good for us. But we just know that even if you just want your ranch to perform better, this is going to work. And all it is pulling the carbon that's in the wrong place into the right place. It's better in your soil. All right, next slide. Then this year, as of last week, we just got the data from Colorado State University. All of these NRCS practices, which are now funded through EQIP grants, we have now quantified the carbon sequestration for all of these practices. These are conservation farming practices. That's what they're known by the USDA. But what we've done now with mapping from 40 years of soil sampling done by Bill Parton and different modeling practices, we now know how much carbon we can sequester with all of these practices. There's 23 of them. So we're looking at building carbon farm plans that include everything most people want done on their ranch and farm anyway. This all helps erosion mitigation. It helps build your water table. It helps repair your riparian zones. And it has carbon consequences that are potent and powerful. So now, as of last week, all of this has been quantified for carbon sequestration in soils. That was never known before last week. Next slide. So now we have people on the landscape doing this. We have three demonstration ranches. When we met last time, we were just talking about the science. Now it's on the land. Strauss Family Dairy, Corda Winery, Stemple Creek Ranch have all applied compost onto their rangelands. And Lauren Poncha from Stemple Creek is now making his own compost. And this is 2 years worth of his compost getting spread 10 days ago. So he's making compost on the ranch. He's spreading it himself because he saw the benefits immediately. Even during this incredible drought period, he saw where the compost was applied and what started to happen. Now he's out on his own running. Stemple Creek sells grass-fed beef and lamb to the community. And it's a fourth-generation ranch. I believe it's around 1,500 acres. And it's just out in Tomales Bay area. Next slide. So this is more of Lauren's work. These are iPhone shots. Sorry for the blur. Next slide. So what we're working with Lauren's wool is actually looking at how this wool becomes climate beneficial. And we're looking at how to certify that. And we have done so. We've looked at what it takes to verify for a region. We're not going to go very far outside of this region for now, but we are going to do that. So we've gone onto the landscape and we've looked at educating and sharing what we know. So those of you have this carbon farming little ditty on your chair, this is something that's brought to you by myself or Dustin Kahn or Carolyn Spergen. We've been out on the landscape sharing all of this research with the ranchers and farmers. And our ask, our grassroots action step for all of you is to ask your resource conservation districts. We would like carbon farming as an integral part of the NRCS practice list. Can you help us implement carbon farming on our ranch or farm? Your resource conservation district wants to hear from you. And on a sheet of paper on your chair, you also have a map of the resource conservation district. And if you don't have one, call a neighboring RCD. We'll go to the next slide. So this is what we're looking at here, is that there will be a carbon farm fund. It will come through donations from individuals. It will come through the Air Resources Board. It will come through NRCS dollars. It will come through multiple places. There are ways to garner and aggregate funding that will then help perform the carbon farm plan and help implement it. The carbon farm plan has to come from the rancher. Has to be your vision of what you want for your land based on what is out there. You write the plan with someone from the RCD, and then you implement over a multi-year period. Every year, we can quantify your carbon through something called the Comet Farm Tool, which will be an online tool. And your RCD person can plug in everything you're doing and get those numbers for you. This becomes climate beneficial wool. It can become climate beneficial meat. We, as a third party, the Carbon Cycle Institute and Fibershed, are going to verify that. That goes into the marketplace as revalued wool. It's wool that all of a sudden has a higher price tag, and it deserves to because you're caring for the land in a new way. And so we enter into the sale of goods. 1% of the sale of those goods go back into the Carbon Farm Planning Fund. We're closing the loops economically. We're closing the carbon cycle, the water cycle, and the economic cycle. Next slide. So we are building partnerships simultaneously with brands and artisans. Who wants to use climate beneficial wool and tell the story of land regeneration? Who are those people? So California-based brands have come out and they've started early partnerships towards this end, and artisans as well, multiple scales of production, multiple people using this good wool and telling the story of riparian restoration, soil restoration, et cetera. Next slide. If we can build a demand, we go back to square one, where we have what it takes to build the facilities, multiple facilities, or just a several, to process the undervalued wool. We don't have the demand we need to currently add value to the wool regionally. We have to send the wool out. That's, the undervalued commodity market wool. So to create the value, we need the demand. So we'll use processing in North Carolina and what have you in between time, but we really see the climate beneficial piece as a way of revaluing and giving something that enhances what we have here locally, and then creating what we need to make the case for regional production of the commodity market wool. Next slide. And so today, again, going back, so this is what the plans are, this is the strategy. What we're doing today is building off the soil. So this is a salon of people who go way beyond what I've just described. These people have been using their wool, making sure it gets to market, taking responsibility for their land, taking responsibility for what they do. They're way ahead of the curve I just described to you. But that's what this room is about. We stay three steps ahead, and we keep, as we come together in these rooms, we share ideas and experiences to evolve this strategy, because we're all part of it. So today you're going to hear the ecology part, pollination, predation, and pasture management. We're looking at what comes off of healthy soils and how to enhance that more. And the diversity in the field also has to do with breed diversity, and our first panel is related to that. So these are the people from our first panel today in front of you, and they're pictured here in the next slide. You're gonna hear from Project Coyote, which is about fostering coexistence. They'll be next after the breed panel. And then the third, you're gonna hear about pasture management and pollination from Richard King and Jim Jensen and Robin and Heather Gamper. And so that's how the day will go. It's about breed diversity, it's about predators and pollination, and it's about coexistence. So again, the layers on top of the soil are being developed in our agricultural salon today. Next slide and last slide. Just an Aldo Leopold quote for you. The land is not merely the soil, it is a fountain of energy flowing through a circuit of soils, plants, and animals. And that's what today is about, the energy flow from the soil on up. So again, thank you all for being here, and we're gonna go right into our panel. And this panel may not have time for questions because it's a large panel. So I want you to catch all of these people out in the room and in the garden today and ask your questions of them when you see them. If we could start, actually, Robert, can we start and then move down? And I'll ask the question out loud and then we'll start. So what are the experiences, and they could be serendipitous or personal values, and these could be economic values or environmental values, which have led to your choice towards the animal breed? And I should just say, also, I want to just add one thing. Third generation?
Yep.
That Robert Irwin is a third generation rancher, and he he's a seed stock producer, or you were when you were a kid, and you didn't become a commercial producer until 24. But he has raised purebred Suffolk that have been in his family for three generations. And he just moved to California 4 years ago. And they need a sheep that could handle the rain and be capable of drought conditions and have a high heat tolerance for their summers. So Corriedale was his sheep, and they have 400 breeder ewes, 2,700 feeder lambs in pear orchards, alfalfa stubble, walnut orchards, and vineyards. He shears 7,000 sheep a year as a side job. And he runs a family business called Chaos Sheep with his wife Jamie and his daughter Claire. And they're out with him every day with the sheep. So Robert, do you want to talk a little bit more about what brought you to this choice?
We lost our minds. And got into the chose to stay in the family business of raising sheep. We chose the Corridale breed after we moved down to California. Mainly, every dollar that you make with an animal is an extra dollar. Every cent makes a dollar. And when we go through shearing time with the Suffolks, it costs more to shear the sheep than we got in return for the wool. And then as we were sorting through sheep, we were trying to do vineyard management with sheep, graze vineyards, vegetative management, and canopy management. And the Corridale, actually, one of the main reasons why we chose it was its disposition. It had nothing to do with its wool quality or all those things helped lean us to it, but they're very gentle disposition. They're a herding type sheep, but not as prolific at that as like a Rambouillet or a Merino. So they flock together, but they're a little, you know, a Cheviot will take off and run through a vineyard and rip everything down if it, you look at it funny. Where a Corridale will be more docile, and so that's where we chose with that. And going through that process, we ended up in Australia. We looking for the perfect Corridale, the right frame size, the better quality wool, a more consistent wool from the front of the sheep to the rear end of the sheep. And now they're black feet, they're drought tolerant, they're foot rot resistance, they produce a very good marketable meat lamb, but their wool quality, and the more I've been around them, has really been surprising. And the pounds of wool harvested off of those animals compared to the other breeds is pretty promising as well. Last year, our ewes averaged 10 pounds of fleece, and we're working on that. We're still behind Australia by quite a ways, but we've just invested a bunch more money. We got 100 straws of semen that just got here about a month ago. We'll be using this spring in our ewes, and we're going to improve that. You know, the Corridale is a really diverse breed. It's a kind of a blend of several things, but it's you can be used in almost any aptitude. But the Suffolk, we still have that. I can't get rid of those, and they wreck everything we're trying to do in a vineyard, but we're gonna figure out how to keep them. But we do have some Rambouillet ewes. We have about 80 Rambouillet ewes. And the value, it's all about dollars returned on your investment. And the Corridale fits our category a little bit better. Only on the sense that we did a little test last year. We bred our purebred Suffolk ewes to a Suffolk ram, our Corridale ewes to a Suffolk ram, and Rambouillet ewes to our Suffolk ram. Our Corridale cross lambs were 10 pounds lighter than our Suffolks, and our Rambouillets were 15 pounds lighter than our Suffolks at weaning time. So if you take in the economic value across the board, the Corridales didn't produce as high quality or many dollars returned on the wool as the Rambouillets did, but across the board, and that's kind of what we're always shooting for, is we don't need the best, we need them really good at everything. And the Corridale is that breed for us.
Thank you, Robert. And there's so much in that, so I hope you find Robert later today and ask him more about that. And I would like to just introduce Mimi really quickly. I met Mimi. She's my introduction to West Marin wool. She's my introduction to wool, truly, in this area. So thank you so much, Mimi, for being here. And her beautiful bio, she's a writer, and she also is a fan of Corey Dale's. And she really is the educator in our community and really holds the space for all of us on her farm so many times a year to learn and to experience what it is to have a life with sheep and dyes and honoring food and fiber cycles all in one. So thank you, Mimi.
Good. I'm delighted to be here today. And I came to Corridale's kind of through the back door and a lot less scientifically. I really admire your work, because I'm much more higgledy-piggledy. I did have a sheep guru as well, who's sitting at the very end of the panel down there, Miss Ann, who I was referred to as the shearer that I needed to get, so I called and pled and begged, and she came to help me. And I started about 20 years ago. I grew up on a farm with sheep, but I left the farm when I was 7. So I never got any serious chores. I just remember the cute little lambs and the cute little chicks and the cute little puppies. And I was living in Oakland, and I just had to leave. I had a beautiful brown shingle. I had my little writing nook in the back of the garden, and it was too bad. I had to go. So I landed out in the Chileno Valley, a perfect area for grazing. And I had met a wonderful woman, Judy Lang, who absolutely enticed me with these beautiful Lincoln sheep that had a pearl, just beautiful pearly luster and the soft waves of crimp. And so I bought 10 sheep from Judy. Just, Judy, send me 5 old and 5 new. And after I sheared the first year, nobody wanted the wool. That was a little bit of a sit down because it was too coarse. And that has started me on my career of helping you guys understand that fine merino wool is not the best wool to have. And that's where I so agree with Robert. That you don't want merino. But I moved from, there's a spectrum where you, on one end, you have beautiful luster, and you have this wavy crimp, but it is coarse, it's scratchy. It's got a very high PF factor, and that stands for prickle factor. And on the other end of the spectrum is the very fine merino that will shred in minutes because it's soft, it's not strong. But right in the middle are our beautiful Corridales. And so I began crossbreeding my Corridales to come up, well, my Lincolns with Corridales to come up with wool in the middle that had as much as I can, and Anne will disagree with me here, but I was after both luster and crimp, which, as Anne points out, is really impossible, but I'm after that anyway, seek the impossible, which is why I'm a sheep farmer, right? Going for the impossible. And so the Corridales have, the crosses have worked very, very well for me. And I have, of course, there is a little, you know, everybody's kind of a hypocrite because I fell in love with Shetland sheep. So I also have a flock of Shetland sheep, and their wool is much finer. But they are so eccentric and crazy and wild that it somehow balances all of that. And then thanks again to Anne, I began to get alpacas. So I am working with the fact that I have a market that only wants soft, and I don't want to raise sheep for a variety of reasons that have soft wool. So I'm blending my Corridales now with the alpaca to create a wool that has luster. It has crimp and it has softness, and yet it is durable and strong. And I hope you all, we kind of quickly pulled together a little display out there of fabrics that are made from scratchy wool. They're durable. That's what we want. We want durable wool clothing. And at the farmer's market where I sell, I can see a handmade older sweater that's 30 years old when it walks down right in front of me, and I can always snag it and talk to the person about it. Yeah, my grandmother made this for me, or yeah, my mother made this for me 20 or 30 years ago. So I want to encourage you to think about the fact that you know about merinos. Merino, the marketing, New Zealand, Australia, has taken over that name, and that's all you know. Think in the cattle world, think Black Angus. You only know Angus beef. You don't know about Herefords. You don't know about all the other beef breeds that have wonderful meat. And so with merino, my cause today is for you to learn that, as you can see in the back here, there's so many other breeds of sheep. And it's so important that we learn about those breeds and we're willing to buy that wool because it has great durability, it has a great place in our lives. So think all the brands and the different kinds of breeds of sheep we have, and let's cherish them. Thank you.
Thank you, Mimi. And
Wonderful. And Marie is the Fibershed Farmers Market Manager, if you've seen her. She's in Oakland and Larkspur, and she's bringing fresh farmed fiber to the farmers markets and integrating the food and fiber system consciousness out on the landscape all the time. We're so grateful for Marie's efforts. And she's also started a really innovative breeding program that is out on the landscape where she is a young agrarian making her way in the world in a magical way. And I'm honored to have you here. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, it's funny that I started with the farmers like marketing wool specifically, because really my interest is not the products that come from the animals. It's really coming from a land management interest, which is basically, I think, how I somehow fell into having this breed of really rare sheep. I don't really know how I ended up here. 3 years ago, I probably would have been like, oh, a sheep, yeah, a lamb comes from sheep, right? I don't know. I've learned a lot of keywords in the last 3 years, let me tell you. and I've seen your wool, Mimi, and I think that both luster and crimp you've accomplished. And I know enough now that I know what those things are. So the products, the wool and the meat that comes from these animals is really not a good reason to have my breed of sheep. I have tiny sheep, Waissant sheep. They are, I think the pure breeds are like 40 pounds each. Like, I'm sure the meat is good, but there's not very much of it. The wool is beautiful. It's amazing. Susan made this out of it. It's gorgeous. It's really for very specific hand crafters. There's very little that comes off it. It's like probably about 5 pounds that come off them. It's not uniform at all. Like, it's different levels of like softness, of coarseness. It's not like the kind of wool that you would expect to be sought after. Which is part of why I started the farmers market, is because when I was starting to think about having sheep, I was like, well, I don't have any contacts. I'm going to need like a way to sell the wool that I'm going to have from these sheep that I'm going to have someday. So I better start selling other people's wool so that I'll have the outlet. So that's kind of ironic because this wool, it's really different. But what I've found about it is that it's really valuable, because it's basically like, it's not a dying breed anymore, but it's a really rare breed, and it's something that you can't find anywhere. So the farmers market actually turned out to be totally unnecessary, because people were like calling me from across the country, like, do you have Waissant sheep? I want to buy your fleece. I will give you like $100 for 2 pounds of wool. And I was like, what? Okay. That's not super, that I'm not really like expecting my business model to be that, but a lot of serendipity has come into what I'm doing. And so mainly why I'm using this breed of sheep is land management and land practices. And they're a primitive breed, so they're very well adapted to the landscape. They come from the coast of France, which is a very similar kind of terrain to West Sonoma. Like Robert was saying, with the dark feet, they are really really land tolerant, really they're meant for the landscape. And that is my real interest in using this primitive breed, is how can we make the genetics from this animal that is otherwise totally unsuited to our current economic system. They, as animals, are actually totally indispensable to keeping up our landscape and the traits that are in them. I think it's really important to keep alive and going. So essentially, if I can give these animals a job grazing orchards and vineyards and doing land management projects with them, they have a reason to keep on existing, no matter the economics that are involved.
Thank you, Marie. And Leslie also, Leslie Adkins is going to describe her work, but she manages Heartfelt Fiber Farm, and it's a mini fiber farm in West Sonoma, and it's truly inspired by her love of natural fibers and respect for an animal's full life. So do you want to describe a little bit more about your mixed breeds and such, Leslie? Thank you.
Yes, I have a unique, I call it a mini eco fiber farm in West Sonoma. And I come to being a shepherd late in life after a career in environmental science and ecology and a lifelong love of animals and of natural textiles and handmade fiber things. I don't have time to tell that story, except that I can say that we got to this point from the step of owning the Inverness Valley Inn, which my husband and I turned into a green, eco-friendly lodging. And part of that was adding a little mini farm for education of guests. When we sold the inn, we moved to West Sonoma, and I was able to continue my study and on the land practice of raising fiber, diverse fiber, in a humane way, in an eco-friendly and carbon-beneficial way, which is quite a challenge. There's sometimes conflicts. But I learned about climate change before almost anyone. Back in the 70s, I was in graduate school. I took a course in climatology, and I read those first papers that climatologists were writing about climate change, and that has guided the rest of my life. It's been there for good or for worse. In some ways, I would have rather not having had the burden of knowing what the world is coming to. So what I have done through study and practice is I've developed this diverse herd, tiny 14 animals, diverse species, three kinds of sheep, all primitive sheep, because I believe that the fibers from the primitive sheep in the long run, or the way I'm doing things in the long run in the world, is going to be the way to go, because in my feel, my beliefs, in the long run, we won't have the luxury of raising sheep for meat because it's not carbon beneficial. And the primitive breeds that we have, including the Wessons and the Icelandics and the Shetland, are all have more diversity genetically and use less input of energy for output of beautiful fibers. And that's where we are.
So, and next to Leslie, we have Lani Estill, who's come all the way from Modoc County. And I've been to Lani's place, and it's absolutely beautiful, going up to the Surprise Valley. So Lani and her husband, John, own and operate an integrated, diversified livestock operation producing cattle, sheep, alfalfa, grass, and hay. And Lani has a BS degree from the University of Bachelor's. Sorry. Bachelor's degree from the University of Nevada, Reno, in agricultural economics. And they have four children, 6 to 24, and are actively engaged in the livestock industry. And the older two children have now their own sheep operation. And Lani has always loved the wool aspect of the sheep and has encouraged the use of fine wool breeds to produce the best quality wool possible in a rangeland operation. So she raises Rambouillet, and they produce 30,000 pounds of Rambouillet per year. And we've been really inspired to meet Lani and John and understand how you raise a family with a land-based business, and you make it work on every level. Not easy, a lot of energy, and just really powerhouse people. I'm really glad to have you here today.
Thank you, Rebecca. I'm glad to be here. We're from the high desert Fibershed, so our area is much more arid than what you experience here. our choice of using the Rambouillet breed, you know, it started by accident, so to speak, when we got into the sheep business 20 years ago. Our first herd flock that we bought was Rambouillet. They were a fine wool sheep, and I enjoyed the wool aspect of that. And then as we continued to expand and think more about breed, we continued with the Rambouillet breed because of the fine wool, and because they're so gregarious, work well in a range operation. So, you know, we could have looked at Columbia or something like that, maybe a little bigger lamb product, but we stuck with the smaller animal and are working with that by using some of the Cunningham sheep operation or sheep company breeding, which does give you a larger Rambouillet lamb, but still has that fine wool quality. We do cross our ewes with Suffolk and Hampshire bucks to get the terminal cross, which is the larger value lamb for meat purposes. I wanted to mention our the other breed or breeder that we use for bucks is the Rafter 7. Merinos Incorporated, I believe is their new name. Rafter 7, if you've not been familiar with them at all, is started with the University of Nevada, Reno, and out of Yerington, Nevada. And their wool has been the highest value wool clip in the last 14 years in the whole United States. The last 3 years, they had the nicest fleece in Boonville, their fleece contest. And they've really influenced the breeding of commercial flocks, range flocks throughout Nevada and the West Coast, Nevada mostly, I would say. So Rafter 7, that's a name to remember. They were recently purchased, and I didn't bring those notes, by Tom Powers, and he's out of South Carolina. I don't want to say it wrong, but the Limpiar Sheep Company. I believe, is his company, and they bought that flock because of the value of the wool. So that's the influence we're trying to bring in to meet this desire that people are wanting to have the nice wool that Rebecca's wearing against her skin, mm-hmm. That really nice fine wool.
We can layer on our bodies with multiple breeds, so we got... I'm all about the Corriedale sweater on top of the Rambouillet base layer. Okay, sorry, go.
There we go. She said 30 seconds, but we have more questions, so I have more to tell you. But we'll continue.
Okay, thank you, Lani. I appreciate it. And again, arid soils, just we'll make that connection, but when you're really up there and you see the emergence of the Great Basin, mm-hmm. and how that would, you know, direct you to choose a different species than if you were in the fog-laden areas. We covered that in our first symposium, but moisture and moisture content changes a lot of the decisions you make, too. So just want to emphasize that's the diversity piece.
Yeah, I might not have got that, but the arid soils is a big reason for the merino and that fine wool. Sometimes you can't do that with what we experience on the North Coast.
Yeah. Thank you so much. And then Mary is... Mary Pettis-Sarley. She is a woman who runs around a 2,000-acre land base in the Carneros area of Napa, and she's the first person, second person, outside of the work I did with Mimi in the beginning of the Fibershed Wardrobe Challenge. I headed to Mary's ranch, pretty much the second or third ranch I went to, and was mesmerized by an artist living on the land, and there's an article about her that I wrote a couple years ago called The Art of Ranching. So, you know, Mimi being a writer, Mary being a potter, and a textile artist, and a photographer, you bring all of this creativity into the landscape through, both of these women really inspired me, and Mary, I just want to thank you so much for everything you've brought, just this playful, creative. You showed me a clown riding a donkey backwards once.
A pig.
And you said, this is me at the ranch. And I would agree, it's a fun place.
I came to all of this probably in an unnatural way. I grew up in the suburbs, and I went to college in textile design, and somehow I ended up renting a cottage on a ranch in Napa, a cattle ranch, and I realized that was the love of my life, was ranching. And so I cowboyed for 20 years. And one day, the neighbor got some sheep, and one came down the road, and I had done textile design. I had been a spinner for a long time. And so I really learned ranching, and then started kind of delving back into fiber again. And I realized if there are two ways to go about fiber, I think. One is you have the breed of sheep you love, and then if you take it farther, a yarn of your dreams, and then you find a mill to process it, or you find a mill you love and put your flock together around a yarn that you want to make that you know goes through a certain mill. And so when I had a few sheep, I thought, okay, I need to know way more than what I know. So I went to Yolo Wool Mill, and I worked at Scouring Co-op for a couple of years, and then I worked at the mill for a couple of years, and I could get my hands on so much fiber. And I loved it because I could see it dirty, I could see it clean, I could see how it went through the mill, and then from that, I realized there was one kind of yarn that over and over and over I really loved. It was Mimi's. Mimi made awesome yarn. And so I realized it's a semi-worsted mill, and I put together my flock basically with long wools. And Anne sheared for me my first few sheep a long time ago, and I realized people like soft. I was making this yarn. I like rustic yarn. I like scratchy yarn. But I realized a lot of people don't. So I've moved to another part of the same ranch, another area, and I live at the edge of the forest now. So my sheep need to be a little spunky. We have predators that live in the forest, and everybody has a job. I use guardian dogs, I use donkeys, I use llamas, I use alpacas as guardians, and then I have spunky sheep. I can't have quiet sheep. So in order to make the yarn I love and that I really like, I have long wools, basically. I love luster. And then I've learned that through blending, I can make the same sheep become really soft yarn or more rustic yarn. And so I just play.
And you run cattle as well.
I run cattle as well, and it's nice. As I came off the mountain this morning, I looked out. I've let all the sheep out. So the sheep are on 1,200 acres, and they know to bed down with the cows at night. I mean, everybody's just, even the cows have a job. You know, and the alpacas, I run 100 alpacas up on 600 acres with the cattle. And everybody just gets along.
And you see that when you go visit. It's a community of species. Thank you, Mary. And then we have Anne, who is an alpaca and sheep shearer, and she has been living in Idaho for some time and is now up in the Mendocino area. And Anne is just this name that comes through our Fibershed community, for me at least, all the time. And in reference to Anne and Anne, this, it's like a brain trust, Anne, like that you carry, and people bring your name and your information through. And I'm really glad you came down to be here in person with us in the physical.
Yeah. Thank you. I've been in this for close to 40 years now as a commercial shearer. That's how I earn my living. I've raised two sons as a shearer, and I'm a fiber artist, a hand spinner. And this is, I began as a horse girl from Mill Valley. Animals have always been top of the list for me. And when I began shearing, I had a dairy goat herd at the time, So I stepped off into Angoras, which was easy, fell in love with luster, continued with long wools. Each year I would choose another breed for my ram to put on my girls. No one's mentioned, but luster is much like silk in that it picks up dyes just brilliantly. And so this is something that you get a depth to your yarns then that you don't get with the fine wools. As a shearer, fine wool is a dirty word to me. Fine wool sheep have a much thinner skin, so there's more blood during shearing, which just irks me. I mean, that just, I can't handle that. So I prefer to shear the long wools. They have tougher skin. I've been shearing for a lot of the people on the panel here and some of you in the audience for many, many years. I travel around. Physically, my knees were giving out because I specialize in hand spinning flocks, which means that I tend to be a slow shearer. And so you're holding the animal much longer with your knees. Right about the time I was trying to make the decision between walking and shearing, did I want to walk or did I want to shear? And there was a long, I figured out I had to walk. Right then the alpaca craze hit. And you don't have to hold alpacas between your knees. So I went, gotcha. So I shear alpacas now, which alpacas are not my favorite animal. And I don't particularly care for their fiber. But that's just me. It's a hair. There's a difference between wool and hair. Mohair, alpaca is a hair. So if you're a hand spinner and you deal in fibers, this is what you want to be aware of. I support myself now a lot with textiles, hand spun yarns, and some dyeing. So that's where I'm at these days.
And Mary and Anne, do you have anything to say about the alpaca project?
That's a little further down the list, isn't it?
Sure, okay, we'll go there then. All right, thank you. So the next question will go back to Robert, and so you've heard about the breed, and we've heard iterations and ideas popping out about the land base, but we're gonna hit that now. Describe the geography and land base, and how is your breed a good match for where you are located? Because a lot of what defines what we love and what we're passionate about is also about how the animal fits in with the landscape. So let's hear. Where do you live? What do you do with your sheep?
Thank you. I live in Lake County. We graze our sheep in Lake Mendocino and Colusa County during different time periods of the year. The reason why, going back to the Corridale, the one thing I really liked about it, Corridale, little known, is the world's most popular breed. There's more Corridales in the world than there is of almost any other breed, except if you think of China, because they don't really publish anything, it's really hard to tell what's in their country. But if you go into South America and those areas, and the reason why a lot of breeders use the Corridale is the drought tolerance. They can handle the heat, they can handle moisture, weather climates. They're adaptive to pretty well anything. They can't handle the rainfall of, let's say, right here. It'd be a little wet for right here, but the foot rot resistance and all the other, the parasite stuff, if you go down the list, there's been a lot of work done in the Corridale throughout the world. The Corridale breed in the United States is almost non-existent. I would put it on the endangered species list because as looking for sheep to buy, to put your numbers together, they're really difficult to find. So when we moved down into our area, trying to put which used to be, I think at one point there was, I might be wrong, but there was, I think, around 300,000 sheep in Mendocino County, maybe a little bit more. I think during certain times of the year, I'm the largest producer, and I might more than triple the amount of sheep in Mendocino County during certain times of the year. But that used to be the Corridale sheep. Corridales used to be extremely popular in the United States, and they've kind of fallen off, mainly to do with the wool, the price of wool. In our system, when you look at, you know, how do you get a lamb fat? How do you get the wool raising lambs and all that? So when we, in today's world, the economic value of lamb or land is much more valuable to do other things with it than raise sheep. And in our trick in Mendocino County was to get the lambs, the sheep, back down on the valley floor where the land is more fertile, raises a higher quality of feed. And that's where you'll get your pound to gain on with your lambs. So we had to figure out how to get into the pear orchards and the vineyards and all of the other crops that people are producing to pay for the economic value of that land. The hill country is really good in the summertime, and that's where you need to, like, the breeds of sheep, like if you have a Romney and you take it to the Central Valley, it will melt in the heat. It's just not, where a Corridale is, in Rambouillet even more so, can handle the heat. But the Corridale for us was that really, we could go anywhere. We could put them on a truck, send them to the Central Valley, graze alfalfas, they could turn 110 and we wouldn't have a problem with the animal. That was why we went that direction. But they're really, you know, they're really well adaptive animals.
And what are the three places you take them in the year?
Right now, all of our sheep are in Clusa County grazing alfalfa stubble. We're trying to figure out how to eliminate using chemicals and sprays in most crops as a residue. And then we're lambing our sheep right now. And they're in Calusa County twice a year now, and that was something I never forecasted, but we graze walnut orchards in Calusa County in the summertime, and that's where we bred our ewes in May and June. And then they'll go on the first of the year, they'll land in Mendocino County in the vineyards. They'll spend there until bud break. We'll go up into the non-crop areas and the hillsides from then until the first of June. Half of our sheep will stay in there and graze the canopy and do canopy management for the vineyards. And then, so we do leaf picking once the fruit's set. That's a whole different speech. And then when we come out of there, then we go back up into the hills. And then on September 1st, they pick the fruit on the pear trees. And as soon as the last pear is picked, we turn the sheep loose to eat rotten pears. And we graze from the 1st of September to the 15th of November.
Mm. Wow. Yeah. And it's an evolving rotation. When I first met you.
It's changed a lot. The first thing I said is I lost my mind is correct statement. Yesterday we were shearing some lambs because all of our sheep have to be sheared before they walk into the vineyard. They'll rip the drip lines off. So we are getting all of our sheep in the cycle of shearing them so we have a full clip during that time frame. And we were getting the shearing trailer and everything set up, and I got a whole bunch of sheep shearers standing there, and this guy flies in a car, and he, in a, you know, SUV, and I thought he was going to yell at me that my sheep were out. And he hops out, and he's all, "Who's Robert?" And I said, "I am." And he says, "I want your sheep in my walnut orchard." It's a huge difference from where I was 5 years ago. Usually, you know, my grandfather jokes around with me about this, but our sheep are in places that used to be a shootable offense. And it's true. I mean, you just, one of the shearers was from Oregon, and he says that's never happened to him in his life. We're having to say no for grazing, grazing jobs, and I've never had to do that before. I had to talk people into it when we first started.
Good. And that's only been a few years. So wonderful. Thank you. Good news. Mimi, do you want to describe your land base and geography?
Well, sadly, because of the drought, my land base is mostly dirt on my pastures now. And so I've had to totally rethink what I'm doing and how I'm doing it, because last February I looked at my pastures, and as I say, it was all dirt. And I rotate. I got an equip grant. I have all these cross fencing, but you can only rotate from dirt to dirt to dirt when you haven't had rain for 10 months. So I have had to reassess just about everything, and I haven't come up with a lot of answers. But I had the shock. This is a little astray from our question, but I had the shock of, I had a neighbor said, yeah, I've got a small pasture. We just, I wanted to say shear it, but you don't shear pastures, you shear sheep. We just cut this pasture, and why don't you bring some girls down? So I brought some of my lambs and some full-size ones down. And when I went to collect them, the lambs were the same size as the full-size ewes that I'd taken down. And when I brought them back, my lambs still looked like three-month-old lambs, even though they were 6 months old. So I had to say to myself, you know, not only do you have dirt in your pastures, but whatever grass you have in your pastures is not nutritious enough for my flock. So I sold two-thirds of my flock. Instead of having 65 sheep, I'm down to 25. And I'm reassessing absolutely everything I do and how I do it. The one saving grace is I do have Shetland sheep, and they are very, very easy keepers. They're smaller. They seem to thrive on less, which they had to in Shetland. They had a little bit of seaweed, I guess, in the rocky soil of Shetland, the Shetland Islands. They had a little bit of seaweed. So over the thousands of years they were bred, then they are able to thrive on less nutrition. So my poor Corridales, man, they would love to be in those walnut groves and eating alfalfa stubble. They would be thrilled. So I am faced now, you know, as someone, I always thought of myself as a steward of the land, looking at having to reassess what I'm doing and how I'm doing, because some of my sheep are helpful to the land, but some of them have been very destructive. So I'm rethinking everything. Mm.
Thank you, Mimi.
So I'm in West Sonoma. Similarly, a bit to Roberts, I move my flock around to different properties, a mix of orchards, vineyards, and surrounding areas. The Wesant sheep are primitive breed of sheep. They're really well adapted, as I said before, to the landscape, to a rocky coastal landscape. Wesant means western or westernmost in French. So they're native to the island of Wesant, which is off the coast of France and Brittany. So they're very hardy sheep. They're really meant to make it out on the landscape. I think sometimes they tell me they like don't need me. And yeah, how is that a good match? I've been learning that as I've had them, I think, in putting them in different situations and learning how they work best in various situations. They've surprised me many times with what they'll eat. I was unaware previously that sheep would eat down blackberry brambles, but my sheep do, which is very helpful for some of the work that I'm trying to do. So they were in an apple orchard several weeks ago, and there was a lot of things like poison oak and blackberry brush and coyote brush and things that are kind of like your sort of first layer of stuff that comes up that will then make way for like forests to come in or for like sunlight to be blocked from the orchard. So the fact that they were able to eat that stuff down, whereas otherwise you would have like a person going in there with like a weed whacker or whatever, or trying to like hand mitigate things like poison oak and blackberry, I found that to be really incredibly helpful. So a lot of what I'm doing is me being really creative, I think, and just kind of seeing what the best use I can make of the sheep in the given context is, and learning a lot as I go.
Sheep that eat poison oak, I love it. All right. Leslie.
It's good for them.
Yeah. It is. It's very good for them, yeah. So we moved our little flock, and it's expanded a bit from Inverness, from Third Valley Inverness, which is moist and foggy in summer and sort of warmish in winter, to the Santa Rosa floodplain, which is the second largest wetland in freshwater wetland in California. It was originally grassland, and like we live on near Llano Road, which Llano means the grasslands. So that land, it's a high water table. It's really suitable for grazing. And I know in the research I've done about the future of the world, in the long run, the people who look at the larger picture say that in the long run, livestock probably should only be grazed in areas that are sort of marginal for other crops. And the our area really is best for grazing. So that's good. It's a high water table, lush grass. We have these three primitive species of sheep, which are way more efficient in terms of energy input eating. My Icelandic sheep get sometimes too fat on the good grass, and if I feed them in the supplemental time of year when you feed hay, if I feed them what the books say for, you know, 1.5% weight, they still are too fat, so they eat less than other sheep and produce a lot of beautiful fiber in the meantime. We also, because it's a high water table, we're careful to, they go in at night to one area. We compost all of that manure in hot compost, and that manure goes back out onto the pasture and into the gardens. And because we don't send them off for meat, it's sort of like a closed system. The animals stay there, they make the fiber, which does sequester carbon. And other than bringing in some hay because of the drought, it's pretty good ecologically.
And what are the, you have Icelandic and
the Ouessant and the Shetland, which are all in the northern European short-tailed family of primitive sheep. And I haven't gotten a chance to comment on what Mimi was saying, but their fiber is wonderful. It's got luster and it's got crimp. They're dual-coated. And they come in multiple colors, so it's wonderful for hand. And the big mills don't handle it very well. It's got to be processed on small scale.
Thank you. So our geography and land base, we're the high desert, and our sheep operation is a range sheep operation. We start out, if you're starting with the breeding cycle, we start out on our alfalfa fields, which at home we raise our own alfalfa, and that's where we breed them. We also use some neighboring alfalfa ranches as well for that purpose. Then they go out into the BLM permit, which is in Nevada, and we walk them. We walk them about 90 miles to the far east side, and then we turn around and walk them back. So they're in bands with guard dogs and herders who live out in their camp trailers. And so that brings us December through March. They'll be out on the range in Nevada. A lot of times they don't even have water. Where the best scenario for us is that it snows a little bit so that they can eat the snow. And then they eat their browse animals, so they eat white sage, bitterbrush, desert grasses, other range plant species that are out there. Grass is not the majority of their diet. They work well with other animals. One of our allotment has, well, two of them actually have cattle also, and since the cattle prefer the grasses, they work well together. Okay, so then we walk them back towards our ranch, which is on the Nevada-California border, and we lamb them outside. We do have one band we lamb in our barn, and we barn lamb. We've found that the fiber is better on the sheep that lamb outside. For whatever reason, they lamb a little later, or the barn lamb ones might interrupt that cycle of wool growth with having a lamb. And provide a little break, have a little breakage there. It's interesting that way. So after their lamb, then their pairs, that takes us up to about April, May, we start taking them up into the Warner Mountains, and they spend the rest of their season in the Warner Mountains, high country, again, cold nights, a lot more grass and bitterbrush, mountain brush in their diet then.
and in August we'll wean the lambs and sell the lambs off of them. Some of the lambs, the smaller lambs, we'll bring back down to the ranch and keep them on the alfalfa for a little while longer. So that's kind of our cycle. They coexist well with livestock. Most of the sage grouse leks that the Department of Wildlife find in our area are on sheep allotments. Just want to address the carbon idea and what we're doing with Rebecca for a minute. We do have one band of sheep that we kept on our pivot this year, and that was mostly because of drought. We weren't comfortable with four bands in our range, so we kept the one on the pivot almost the full year. That's the area we're talking about applying the compost to improve the carbon sequestration, carbon-friendly idea that Rebecca's educating me about.
And you'll use a lot less water.
And we'll use a lot less water.
Less pumping.
Yeah.
It'll be good. Save money, save water.
We want to close the loop on our ranch because we know we produce a lot of waste that could go easily into a compost situation right there on the ranch, and then apply it to the pivots. I don't know how that works in a range situation where you're talking about public lands, but we know we can make a concerted effort on our property right there, and then it's not totally closed loop because the wool and the lamb do come off and go elsewhere. But but that's good because we can provide food and fiber for a hungry nation.
And you do. I look forward to the outfit that we can all wear from the people sitting up here. Thank you, Lani. Yeah. And Mary, do you want to talk a bit about geography?
We live in a really hilly situation, and it is grazing land only. That's all that it's good for. I have mostly Romney and CVM crosses, and I'm a commercial herd, so I've crossed all over the place to get to a certain place. In the last few years, I got Shetlands, same, and they're a little naughty. They're really naughty. But even if they get out, it doesn't matter. I have one pair that stayed out a mile and a half away from the house. And this little ram, when the predator came, he slammed him. And so now when the sheep go way out, I always make sure that ram goes, because I know he's, even though the dogs are there and there are other things, I need all the help I can get predator-wise. That is probably my biggest issue. Are the predators. I've done a lot of creek restoration. I have a mixed flock. I have goats, I have sheep, and I have alpacas. And it is very nice. You put them into an area, and it's like these levels. The alpacas eat up top, and the sheep eat, and the goats. And it's really nice. So I've been able to do a lot of shaded fire breaks and creek restoration with the combination. The sheep eat thistle, which is really nice. When I just turned them out because the grass is just long enough they can get their lips on, they've totally gone through all the thistle and eaten it all. So for me, that's really nice. I think that they work with the cattle, and it is mostly grazing. I feed alfalfa, but if I can let them stay out, I do.
And you run the alpaca through on the 600 acres, and they're also a predator deterrent.
That's right. And the male alpacas are up. We have a lot of native grasses up on the field where the male alpacas are, which would be like South America. I mean, it's the perfect situation. I don't feed them at all, and they're really fat. I was hoping they'd eat more brush, but they don't. They're grazers. And I'm very happy to know that the sheep can be better browsers. My goats are, but it's the predator thing that keeps me from letting them go way, way out.
And it's due to being surrounded by vineyard. Is that right?
No.
How you have forest?
It's the forest. Hmm. I mean, it's the only place where mountain lions can be. It's where they should be. And I use non-lethal predator control because I feel like they have to be somewhere. I just don't like being the only buffet.
Yeah, of all the people on the panel here, I'm basically on confinement. My animals, when I was in Sonoma, I had, the first place was 20 acres, second place was 6 acres, but that didn't hold my numbers down a bit. I moved to northern Idaho because of the price of hay. At the time, I, of course, had the sheep and goats, but then got into raising mules. And being equines, they eat a lot. First cutting alfalfa was $40 a ton. So I don't know if you, but that was, I'm coming. So I feed most of my animals. Now that I've moved back down here, I've cut back, and Mary has most of my breeding stock. Alpacas, I have a lot of alpacas. There's no retirement program for alpaca breeders, and because of the incredible confinement they raise these animals on in the United States, they can't improve. They can't continue to breed because they're not treating them as a livestock. They don't eat them. They don't use them as dog food. They won't put them down. In general, they get to a certain point, you know, when you've only got 6 acres and you've got 30 animals on that 6 acres, you can't keep breeding. So I've become the retirement for alpaca people, and I go around, Mary does too, and picks up alpacas. Up until a certain point, I only had males because I had a fabulous idea, which we'll go into in a bit, breeding program, except because I don't like alpacas, the last thing I wanted was to increase my herd. But so I only kept males, and now a few years back, Mary went, I'll take females and breed. So now we're doing a breeding program together on her place. But still I can take 2-year-olds and older, castrated or not, and they pretty much can wake it. In northern Idaho, my ranch is rocky forest land. I spread manure from alpaca piles, but it still doesn't do much good. You get winter up there, and so you're feeding, basically you have to start feeding in October, and you feed till June. Wow. So there's...
Wow.
Other than that, their browsers up there, they eat up because of their terrible parasite problems. And my sheep and goats, like I say, are in confinement. Goats are browsers. They have fun time in the forest. But, yeah.
Thank you. So because we started a little bit late, we are going to go through question number 3 probably in 1 minute, if that's okay. And you can just be brief about where your wool is marketed. And we'll start with Robert. And so this is about, again, we talk about value-added processing, and there's a diversity of ways that that gets done amongst the people sitting here. And it's good to hear what that's like for these folks now at this time in our manufacturing reality.
So I sell all my wool through Utah Wool Marketing. They're based in Salt Lake City, Utah. I'm a wool buyer, or not really a wool buyer for them, but the people I shear sheep for, I collect wool for them, wait until I get a truckload of it put together, and then ship it back to them. And then, so I've got to drive out there to shear the sheep, and I've got to drive home, so might as well take the wool with me and save everybody, and I make a little bit of money that barely covers, doesn't even cover the fuel to get home, but... I probably buy about 5 to 6 truckloads of wool that go through, go into Utah. There isn't a large enough amount of sheep in the United States of one breeder, really, to have enough of one type of wool to fill a container to make it to China. And unfortunately, I believe that's where most of my wool goes, except for last year, I was in South Carolina, and I saw a bale of my wool that was going to Burlington, which I was pretty excited about.
Wonderful.
And that's the first time I ever heard anything like that. But the reason why I'm here and I'm super excited is getting a wool mill in the state of California, and getting the people like us to have wool that I can walk down the street and see my wool on people that walking along. I think that's the coolest thing ever.
Thank you.
So I process my wool at Yolo Wool Mill, which is in Woodland. And I've worked very closely with Jane in the last 15, 17 years. And my wool as a medium range wool does very, very well on her machines. And I think that's one thing that some people don't understand. You can't just send any wool to any mill because the machines are very sensitive and they know what they like and they like what they know. And so some people with very, very fine wool, that wool won't work with the machines that are in a particular mill. But I work very well with Jane, and Jane is terrific and long-suffering for us, all of us wool people who come to her and want different kinds of things from her mill. So most of it I sell myself at farmers markets or at events on the farm. I am trying to set up a situation now with the knittery in Knitterly in Petaluma, where I will become kind of their house brand, and my wool will go and she can design the yarns, and that'll be kind of a house brand for a local knit shop using wool from her area. So I'm hoping that will work out. I love the farmers market, but there are other things to do. So the other way I do is I work a lot. As we said, the other kind of mill I'm trying to set up is educating people about wool and animals. And so the on-farm events are very, very important so people can see the animal, feel the animal, and then see the yarn that is made from it, and hopefully go home and knit something from that animal that they know.
So make sure you check out Windrush Farm events, and they're all through the year. Thank you, Mimi, for doing that education and outreach for our community.
Yeah, it's important.
It is.
Let's see. Okay, so the marketing of wool is something that, for some reason, I think about a lot, even though what my real interest is in land management. So I want to take the second to mention how the Ag Commission or the Ag Commissioners in California, they don't seem to know what to do with wool. They don't seem to really have a category for it. Because basically my market doesn't exist. I'm trying to put wool in the farmer's market, especially in the Bay Area. West Marin, Sonoma, it's somewhat in the farmers markets, but trying to put it into the farmers markets in the East Bay and in San Francisco, the response I get is just kind of like, well, we don't have licensing for it. We don't have a category for it. It's not an agricultural product. Which, like, I've called the Ag Commissioner and been like, so I need a category for wool to be in so that I can sell at the farmers market, and they go, oh, well, wool isn't an like, literally, the woman slowed down as she was saying it. And she was like, hang on, can I have somebody call you back? and they're still trying to call me back and still trying to figure out where to place me and what to do with it. So I want to mention that because I think that, what is it, like 3 million pounds of wool that was discovered that gets thrown out every year?
Well, it's about 1.3 that ends up in an orchard or a barn or a landfill, and we have 3.1 million total in the state on average. But that number, Robert tells me, Utah says it's much greater. So, you know, fluxes. But, yeah, it's a lot. We're the biggest producer of wool in this country, California is. So.
Right. So it's actually like a huge product here, but as a commodity, sorry, I'm going to go for a bit. As a commodity, it doesn't have any value to it, and there's no place for it. I think in part just because we don't have the history of it, we don't have a mill, we don't have the infrastructure around processing it here ourselves, and so that, in my small way, I'm trying to sort of comprehend and deal with by making it popular at farmers markets because I see this huge force that has come around California farmers markets around food, and like food security and all these things and popularity. And, you know, now you see like giant billboards for Lucky's being like, oh, like organic local vegetables, you know, like that didn't exist 20 years ago. So me and my little stand at the Temescal market selling your local wool is like, it's very small. I don't know what the real impact is going to be, but my hope is that the market comes into being and that it becomes a force and that it creates demand. And that is largely why I got so involved with it, because that demand is what supports the actual land management and supports me in there being a demand for my sheep to go out and for me to get more sheep and do it more and actually have an impact on the landscape. Which right now I'm just kind of like researching and experimenting with. So I hope the market develops, and I hope we get a wool mill here, and I hope all the infrastructure starts to come around and the licensing and the agricultural licensing and everything that has to do with actually getting it marketed out to the people who want to use it, who don't even know what it is yet. Mm. Happens.
So. Thank you, Marie. Policy and economic development in action. All right. We need it around the fiber system. Thank you. Leslie?
Well, my operation is very small, 14 fiber animals, and at this stage of my life, I'm very happy. Small is beautiful. I don't want employees anymore. I do everything myself. And so I'm very successfully sold at the Point Reyes Farmers Market. It's about the right size market for what I'm producing this year. I took over Mimi's spot, and I enjoy educating people, spend a lot of time talking to people, teaching them about fibers and about eco-farming and about humane practices and beautiful colors. And I'm producing a variety of products, which I think is appropriate for a small farmers market, and providing wool for the community. I sell rovings and a variety of colors and textures and mixtures of wool, of yarn, and some knitted things and some felted things, and I have a lot of fun doing it, because I can mix different colors and textures and create many, many things from this little herd.
Thank you. Lani?
Two aspects of our marketing. One is a commodity producer of wool, and second is an artisan. This year's wool clip, this is very exciting to us. This year's wool clip was purchased by Pendleton Woolen Mills. Yay. They've been looking at our wool for about 3 years, and this year had their ducks in a row so that they could make us a really nice offer on our wool, and we were so happy to have it stay on the West Coast. We've been working toward that. In the past several years, we've been selling through Roswell Wool, and Roswell would then put it on a video auction, and it would go to China and come back in form of a garment. That's always bothered me. So this idea of having a mill here is exciting, and you know, we're all in. I think it's great. As an artisan, I always keep back 3 or 4 fleeces for myself, and with Bonnie Chase's help with Warner Mountain Weavers over in the corner, we market some of my wool through her. We have both colored and white wool that we do. We are currently, because it is fine, can't go to YOLO, we send it to Zeilinger's Wool Company in Frankmouth, Michigan. That's a long ways, but they do a really nice job with the wool, and we're proud to have the comb top in Bonnie's store. And this year we're going to do some sport weight yarn as well, so we're excited about that. So, mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
I am a commercial herd. Flock. I'm small. I'm a one-man band. I do the ranching, I do the washing and blending, and then I send it to YOLO, and they spin fabulous yarn for me, and I dye with plants that are on our property, mostly, and then I sell it to incredible knitting stores. And so I really wholesale mostly. I sell through the Fibershed marketplace. I am at Black Mountain Weavers. I'm at Knitterly. I'm up in Portland, Seattle, New York, and Japan. And I feel very, very happy that it's taken on its own little life.
Twirl. Over there.
Yeah, I'm a fiber hoarder.
As a shear, I get to touch it first when it goes from the animal to I'm the in-between person, so many of these fleeces go into my stash. I don't sell raw fleeces. I upgrade them in some manner, whether it just be washing or dyeing or carding, and I have my very own personal dehairing machine. So, and I'm a hand spinning addict. So I sell hand spun yarns. Mary has helped me to get rid of a lot of my yarns. Yeah, I'm part of the one man band thing.
Ann wholesales to me. And I've started plying her hand spun yarn with my commercial yarn. And so it's kind of taking on its new little life.
And what's the name of that?
Hand Twirl.
Hand Twirl.
And she's hand.
I see. All right. Thank you all. So what we're going to do is it's going to be a last parting words moment before, and we'll into the why the breed diversity is important to you, and why, and anything you could say institutionally that the organizations that exist on the land, how we could do better to promote breed diversity. And again, we want to just be maybe about a minute, if that's okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to be twirl off the subject just a second, because diversity and being in the brand business, like if you're going to sell the larger brand or the wholesale, I think it's all about consistency. And I think the diversity needs to happen. We all don't need to raise the same sheep, but if you have a sheep and you have a one breed of sheep, those sheep need to be consistent amongst themselves, because I think it's very important as we go to get our wool mill, local wool mill, to put local products out. The only way we're going to get people to buy those products is if the wool is consistent from the top of the garment down. I'd be consistent.
The theme of consistency. Thank you. Well, remember that.
I'm not sure how to answer this, actually. I think the only way I can really answer it is to go back to what I said originally, and that is that we have to get all of you and the mills and various other people to recognize the importance of the other breeds, and that they will begin to know other breeds, and what you've said about having Corridales and that they have a consistent product is very important for some of the commercial people. On the other hand, we also need to encourage all the smaller, those of us who are smaller and who can't do it in your size and your size, so that we would find something important in the different kinds of breeds, and that, like anything, the breed, you have to like the breed. You can't raise sheep. Like, I could never raise Suffolks because I don't like them. And I might admire Columbia wool, but they're about the size of a pony, and I can't handle them. They're too big. They would knock me over. And I can depend on my Corridales. They're soft and gentle with me. And the Shetlands, I know they're smaller, but they're going to knock me over if I'm not paying attention. So I think we both have to, on that there are different levels to recognize, and that smaller producers have to have breeds that they fall in love with, and the bigger producers have to have breeds that will be successful in the larger marketplace.
Well said. Thank you.
I guess I would say that, to me, a lot of this question has to do with just figuring out what applies where. There's an awfully lot of breeds out there, and there's potentially a lot of breeds that are going to be created,
I mean, sheep breeding is like, what, 10 or 12,000 years old? And I think figuring out, like, there's a lot of diverse landscapes and a lot of different reasons and ways that you can use wool, and sort of discovering what works best for what thing, and sort of using your education and research and mistakes to just sort of figure that out. I would also mention there's the question on here, are there breeds you feel are missing from the landscape? And I wanna just make a little shout out to the little Santa Cruz Island sheep, which I just wanna let people know about because I just learned about it and I still haven't actually seen one, so I don't know if I actually like them or not. But I like the idea of them, which is that they're native to California sheep. They developed on the Channel Islands, and they're really bred to this landscape, to the coastal California landscape, and they are severely endangered. What? Oh, Robin had some. Ask her about them. Robin, can I see your sheep? I really want to see them. Oh, okay. Well, if anybody has some Santa Cruz Island sheep that they want to show me, I want to see what they look like.
Okay, Leslie.
Well, as an ecologist, for my whole life almost, I've really valued diversity. I understand diverse genes really are what make the world continue. And I, as Mimi said, I think the qualities for small operations are totally different than for the larger operations that need uniformity. And these primitive sheep are wonderful because even within the breed, there's a lot of diversity in Shetlands, Icelandic. There's a lot of diversity in color and textures and intelligence and all sorts of things. And for small operations, I think that's where we have to keep the diversity going and appreciate the qualities that come from the diversity.
Yeah, and I also appreciate the need for breed diversity. I'm glad that we have lots of people in the sheep business so we can have that ability to produce different types of breeds. I'm going to echo what Robert said about consistency. As a larger producer, we need to have that reputation and people know what to expect with our lamb and our wool as well. Since I do value this fine wool and I'm kind of in that mode where we want to produce finer wool and have sport weight stuff that people want to wear every day. I just say that the trade-off has to be with the lamb carcass production because the finer wool sheep are smaller and we need to figure that out. Wool is currently just 10% the value of the lamb. Mm. And with it being just 10% of our income flow, maybe we need to get more money for our wool in order to continue to have that trade-off to produce the fiber, the fine fiber that we need, rather than putting it into the lamb and the bigger breeds. And that's a struggle that we face right now because our average micron count is 22.3. I'd like to see us use more finer wool breeding, but we tend to go towards the larger lamb because that's where the income is to sustain our operation. My kids, because of me taking them to Rafter 7 sales all these years and, you know, spinning wool and being who I am, they are kind of a little bit more in tune to the wool, and they may be the ones mm-hmm. who are headed in that direction towards the finer wool breeds. So we'll see how it goes.
Thank you.
I think there's room for everybody. And I don't want to be like everybody else. And I think not everybody wants the same thing. And the only way you get that is through breed diversity. I think each breed has a strength. Some are soft, some are strong, some have luster. I mean, they're just all different. And they all have a different function in big time. They were bred because they had a function. And a lot of that's been lost now thanks to acrylic. But I think keeping all these things alive is hugely important.
Mm.
I agree with all the purebred, and as a classifier, the purebreds have to remain uniform in their breed. This is really important to keep them uniform, and the fleece, that's a whole nother subject. That's in the classifying discussion. As to diversity, though, this is going to be real quick, just a little experiment, a dream. I have a dream. I had a dream years ago. It was an alpaca dream I found as a hand spinner and a shearer. When I would touch a fleece that has hand, you have to know what hand is. Hand is cold, slippery butter. You touch it, and you just go, oh. I would touch these fleeces that had hand, and very often, and they were a crossbred, a hybrid of Surrey and Wakaya. Now, that's a dirty word in the alpaca business, because at that time, alpaca breeders were selling pedigrees for money. They didn't want any crossbreds. I had this dream one time, but I didn't want to breed alpacas. And I was laughing. I was at Mary's shearing or talking. We don't know what we were doing. And I said, yeah, I'd like to do this, but, you know, I'm not ever going to do it. I'm not going to. I don't want to. Won't live long enough. And she goes, I want to do it. And so she and I are in a hybrid breeding, and my hope was for it to end at the first generation with castration or, you know, well, because once you go past that first generation, you don't know what you're going to get, because it's, you know, your first generation has hybrid vigor, your fleece has hand, it's magical. She wants to get first generation females and keep going. But
only because you get two kinds. Stop. It's not uniform. It's not. It's already kind of a crapshoot.
That's a big diversity. As a hand spinner, as you know, I get to see everybody's backyard all over the Pacific Northwest. So this is just that's a great diversity.
Thank you so much. Just because we started a little late, I said we may not have time for questions, and so what I'd love to do is have you all, you're going to get hoarded by people throughout the day, and that's what I would hope, that your questions continue to them directly in person, one-on-one, because we're going to move to our next group right now. I just want to give them a huge round of applause.